everything that you've given us. Thank you for being here to worship you. Be with all the missionaries that are supported, protected, preach the gospel, whatever lands, whatever governments they might face. Give them the knowledge, the wisdom, to know exactly what to do in any situation. Forgive us of our sins, Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Right, we're finishing up Galatians tonight, chapter 6. Starting in verse 11, we'll read down to verse 18. If you will stand in reverence to God's word.
Amen.
Starting in verse 11 says, "Ye see how large a letter I have written unto you with mine own hand. As many as desire to make a fair show in the flesh, they constrain you to be circumcised, only lest they should suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. For neither they themselves who are circumcised keep the law, but desire to have you circumcised, that they may glory in your flesh. But God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but a new creature. And as many as walk according to this rule, peace be on them, and mercy and upon the Israel of God. From henceforth let no man trouble me, for I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus. Brethren, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Amen."
Amen.
Lord, we thank you tonight for allowing us to be here. Lord, we pray that you would speak to our hearts. Lord, that you would use me as your mouthpiece to preach your word. Lord, to grow us in your grace and to strengthen us in the faith. Lord, that we might stand doing all to stand in the evil day. Lord, we just pray that you'd be with those that aren't here tonight for sickness. Lord, we pray that you would heal. Lord, even for those who are recovering, Lord, from different ailments, we pray that you would put your hand upon them. Those who are traveling, that you would keep them safe. Lord, you know each need. You know each prayer request. Lord, you know each desire of our heart. Pray that you would help us to keep our hearts and minds upon you, Lord, that you might lead us and direct us in your paths. Lord, we give you the honor, the glory, and the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. So he's wanting them to understand just how important this is to them and from him, that he wrote the letter, you know, by himself. He wrote the letter with his own hand, and a large letter it was, because if you don't get the gospel of Christ down, then nothing else is going to matter. If you don't get your salvation on firmly on the foundation of Jesus Christ, then it's all in vain. You have to have your faith only in Christ Jesus, and not in the law for your justification. And so he says, "I've written this large letter by my own hand." And many times he dictated to others who wrote for him, especially in his later ministry as he lost his eyesight and wasn't able to see as good. He had lots of people who helped him. But he wanted them to know that he had written this with his own hand, and that it was very important, because the gospel of Jesus Christ is very important.
Amen.
That we understand that it is not of works, lest any man should boast, but it is by the grace of God. And so that we have our salvation, and by faith in Jesus Christ. And so he says, as many as desire, and there was many that were trying to lure them away. As many as desire to make a fair show in the flesh, in keeping the law. They constrain you to be circumcised only lest they should suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. And you say, well, how would that, you know, help them in not suffering for the cause of Christ? Well, it goes back to the verse of Scripture that we are not of those who compare ourselves with ourselves. But we are of the circumcision. Paul says that that serve God in the Spirit, that worship God in the Spirit, and have no confidence in the flesh. And that's the whole thing about trusting in works for salvation, the works of the law for your salvation or your justification, is that it gives you something to compare yourself with others, to make yourself better than others, to make yourself feel better than others. Is that I do this and I do that, so you know I'm better than someone else. And so that's about what they were doing this for, is to glory in the flesh. Is to say, look at what I've done. Look at what I'm doing. And exactly what Jesus said that they would say to him in that last day when they come to him and say, haven't we done all these wonderful works in thy name? And he's going to say, depart from me, ye workers of iniquity, for I never knew you.
Yeah.
And it's because they cared more about making themselves look good in the flesh, glorying in themselves, having pride, being proud in themselves, instead of giving to God all the glory, giving to Jesus Christ all the glory that is due unto His holy name. Because our salvation is totally of God and not of the works of the law. And so it is a gift of God and not of works. And so we find that there was many who would make a fair show in the flesh, and we find that same today. It's the same way, that there's many who want to make a show in the flesh. They want to seem righteous. They want to seem just. But we understand that the Bible says the just shall live by faith.
Yeah, yeah.
2 Peter chapter 2. Says, but there in verse 1, but there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. And many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. And through covetousness shall they with feigned words make merchandise of you, whose judgment now of a long time lingereth not, and their damnation slumbereth not. And so some of these may have started out right. Maybe some of them have received the truth, but somewhere down the line they turned from the truth and erred from the faith.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible says bringing on themselves swift destruction, because God's not going to put up with it,
amen. Yeah.
Because of all the people that they are leading astray. Mm-hmm. It's sad to hear so many people out on visitation, when you ask them that they are saved, that they have accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior, and they say yes. And then the very next question, if you died today, would you go to heaven for sure? I don't know. Well, if you've accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, the answer to the next question is, yes, I would go to heaven.
Yeah, yeah.
But there's so much disinformation in the gospel that is being preached in churches all across the world, that they have turned the gospel into something it's not, and made it methodology, and made it something that 1, 2, 3, repeat after me, or do these steps. And you have to keep this, and you have to keep that, and do this, and do that. But they don't even know if they have eternal life or not. And that's sad. But the gospel is truly pure. And it's, you know, the the pure gospel is simple to understand, easily to be entreated, the Bible says. Because it's plain. It's easy, but it's so easy that so many people miss it because of such false prophets and teachers who are in the world who distort the gospel. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Verse 1 says, therefore, seeing we have this ministry as we have received mercy, we faint not, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. Many times in reading this, I've often thought, well, he blinds them with the things of the world. He blinds them with the promise of riches and all the things that he can promise in the world. But I don't really think that's the way he blinds them. He blinds them with religion. Just do this and you're okay. Because that's what most people think, is if they are baptized, or if they, you know, go to church, if they have their name on the roll, if they, you know, give money to the church, or you know, partake of the Lord's Supper. I mean, there's so many things in religion that people have been taught that you earn your salvation, that they're blinded to the truth. And it's hard to get them to see the true light of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. It is Jesus Christ and Him crucified.
Amen.
And that's what Paul said, that, you know, I seem to know nothing among you except for Jesus Christ and Him crucified.
Amen.
In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, kind of getting ahead of myself, but that's okay. In verse 18 it says, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God.
Amen. Yeah.
For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. The wise and the prudent he's talking about here. Well, the wise and the prudent in these days were the Pharisees and Sadducees. They were the rulers of this time. They were the ones who were supposed to be the wise men of this time. Yet he's saying, I'm bringing to nothing their wisdom. Yeah. And what is their wisdom? The keeping of the law. And it is not in the keeping of the law. And so he's brought their wisdom down to nothing. In who? In Christ Jesus. That's why they crucified him. Because he brought down their wisdom. He brought them down from their high, lofty places. For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe.
Amen.
For the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness. You see, the Jews thought, well, Christ, the Messiah, was going to come and, you know, conquer the world and set the Jewish nation up to rule. Which the Bible did talk about that. But that's talking about, you know, that millennial, what we call the millennial reign. But it also said that he was going to be born of a virgin. It also said that he was going to suffer for our sins. That he was going, you know, God was going to bruise him. God was going, you know, that by his stripes we are healed. There are many things that the Bible said that showed that he was going to suffer and die for us. And unto the Greeks, foolishness. Why? Because they looked for wisdom and science, or science so called, so falsely called. I mean, it's still the same way today, right? So you have religion and then you have so-called science. And both of them have their own ways, right? Both of them have their own thing. But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God.
Yeah.
Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. You say, well, what was the weakness of God? The cross. He became flesh. He humbled himself. Hold your place right here in 1 Corinthians, because we're coming back to it, but turn to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2 and verse 3. He says, let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind let each esteem other better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man else also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found fashioned as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross.
Amen.
Wherefore God hath also highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name.
Amen.
That at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven, and things in earth, and things under the earth, that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Amen.
So that was the very weakness of God. But he made himself that way. He was a tender reed. But he made himself that way. Jesus came down in the weakness of flesh. And yet, through the weakness of his death, and it was actually the strength, right? That through his death and resurrection, he saved all that come to him by faith. And so even the weakness of God is more powerful than man. Man cannot work their way to heaven. It took God becoming flesh and dying for us to bring us life everlasting.
Man.
Back in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 26, he says, for ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. Why would God become a man and allow people to kill him? They even said the same thing to him when he was dying on the cross. If you're truly the Son of God, if you're truly the Messiah, why don't you come down off of the cross? Right? They mocked at him. But they didn't realize through that weakness, through that death on the cross, he was bringing life, power, and immortality to us. And the base things of the world and the things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and things which are not, to bring to naught things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence.
Yeah.
Ephesians chapter 2 says it. It says, lest any man should boast. Right?
Mm-hmm.
It was the gift of God not of works, lest any man should boast, that no flesh should glory in his sight. It was all on Christ on the cross, paying for our sins. But of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. If we glory in any of those, it has to go to Jesus Christ, because he's made to us all these things. Whatever wisdom we've gained through the scriptures, whatever the righteousness that we have gained, the sanctification and redemption, all the glory goes to Jesus Christ. That according as it is written, he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. And so they wanted to glory in the flesh by making the law their justification, and then making others follow that rule, which they themselves, he said, could not even follow. They can't even keep the law themselves, because we're sinners. We make mistakes. We fail sometimes. But yet, praise God, it's not hinged upon how good of a person I am. Amen. It said, I've accepted Jesus Christ as my personal Savior, that I've put my faith in him, that I've repented of my sins. And so, chapter 2, he says, and I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you, save Jesus Christ and him crucified.
Amen.
And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, the traditions of men, or after the traditions of men, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Not in the wisdom of men or the tradition of men, but in the power of God. And what is the power of God? Well, Romans chapter 1 tells us. Romans chapter 1 and verse 16, Paul says here, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. To everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. If you want to be justified, it's by believing, placing your faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because it is the power of God unto salvation. So they wanted glory in the flesh by the works of the law. But what Paul said in verse 14, he says, but God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. And so what the cross is to us is a yielding of our will for his. And that's what Jesus said. He said, let this cup pass from me, nevertheless, thy will be done. Right? He prayed that for our benefit, to show us it's not about what the flesh wants, right? It's not about what we want. It's about his will being done. That's what the cross means. Jesus says to take up your cross, deny yourself, and take up your cross. That's exactly what it is. It's a yielding, denying yourself, and yielding to his will. That's the cross that we are to bear, is his will.
Yeah.
And when we deny ourselves and we take up our cross and follow him, that's the cross. And which we glory. His will.
Yeah.
So we glory in His will. Not in us, but His. And it, by the cross of Calvary, and that picture of dying to the world, right? And living unto God. That we are crucified from the world. We're crucified from our own will. We're crucified from the will of the flesh, that we might live in the will of God. Verse 1, it says, we then as workers together with Him beseech you also that ye receive not the grace of God in vain. For He saith, I have heard thee in a time accepted, and in the day of salvation have I succored thee. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation.
Yeah.
Giving no offense in anything, that the ministry be not blamed. But in all things, approving ourselves as the ministers of God, in much patience, in afflictions, in necessities, in distresses, in stripes, in imprisonments, in tumults and labors, in watchings and fastings, by pureness, by knowledge, by long-suffering, by kindness, by the Holy Ghost, by love unfeigned, by the word of truth, by the power of God, by the armor of righteousness on the right hand and on the left, by honor and dishonor, by evil report and good report, as deceivers and yet true, as unknown and yet well known, as dying and behold we live, as chastened and not killed, as sorrowful yet alway rejoicing, as poor, yet making many rich, as having nothing, and yet possessing all things.
Yeah.
You see, Paul said, I can do all things through Christ, yeah, which strengthens me. And part of that glorying in the cross of Jesus Christ, submitting ourselves to the will of God, is giving Him the glory throughout all these things that we might have to go through. Some of these, you know, are hard to go through. Evil report, good report, whether people talk good about us or bad about us, right? Whether, we go through stripes and imprisonments, though we go through fasting, though we go through afflictions and necessities, and all the things and circumstances we go through, it's about yielding to the will of God.
Yeah.
It's about saying, not my will be done, but thine will be done. Understanding that we're approving ourselves as the ministers of God. That in everything that we give no offense to the gospel of Jesus Christ, but that we yield to God in everything so that He can use us as ministers of reconciliation.
Yeah.
And so, truly we are to glory in the cross of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
The glory in the cross in which we have yielded ourselves to the will of God to crucify the flesh with the affections and lust, and to say, Lord, use me for your honor and your glory.
Yeah.
Romans chapter 12, verse 1. I mean, that's it in a nutshell. That we are to present our bodies a living sacrifice unto God. Say, Lord, here I am. Use me. This is what Isaiah said. Who will I send? Who will go? Isaiah here I am. Here am I. Lord, send me. That's being given yourself as that living sacrifice, saying, Lord, use me for your will to be done.
Yeah.
And then lastly, he says, and as many as walk according to this rule, peace be on them and mercy and upon the Israel of God.
Amen.
Amen. Peace be on them and upon the Israel of God. It's an awesome thing to realize that the promises are yours. Amen. that peace is yours.
Amen.
And that you are in the kingdom of God. Amen. You are the Israel of God. Romans chapter 2 and verse 25, it says, For circumcision verily profiteth if thou keep the law. Romans 2:25. For circumcision verily profiteth if thou keep the law. But if thou be a breaker of the law, thy circumcision is made uncircumcision. Therefore, if the uncircumcision keep the righteousness of the law, shall not uncircumcision be counted for circumcision? And shall not uncircumcision, which is by nature, if it fulfill the law, judge thee, who by the letter and circumcision does transgress the law? For he is not a Jew, which is one outwardly, neither is that circumcision, which is outward in the flesh, but he is a Jew, which is one inwardly. And circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, and not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of God.
Amen.
The Israel of God is not those who are a Jew in the flesh, those who are Jews in the spirit.
Yeah.
Those who have been circumcised by the hand of God and not by the hand of men. In the spirit and not in the letter. And we have that promise, amen, that it's because of that. In Romans chapter 4 and verse 16, therefore it is of faith, that it might be by grace, to the end the promise might be sure to all the seed, not to that only which is of the law, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all.
Yeah.
And so the promise is made sure to all the seed. And it's not the seed by of the law, but it is the seed of promise to all them that believe.
Yeah.
With faithful Abraham. And so praise the Lord, amen,
amen,
that we have the promise of God, and we are made the children of Abraham by faith in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And has nothing to do with the flesh, but everything to do with the spirit. And what he said, trying to work your way into heaven by keeping the law is trying to do it in the power and the arm of the flesh. But yielding yourself to the will of God, we know what the will of God is, that's to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
When you believe and put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, then he makes you. Amen. As many as received him, to them gave he power.
Yeah.
Come to sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. And so, again, it's the authenticity of the gospel. It is the power of the gospel. And it is the exclusivity of the gospel. There is no other way.
Yeah.
Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me.
Yeah.
He's the only way. through Him we have access into that grace. Amen. By faith in which we stand. And now through the Spirit we're able to live for Him and to submit to His will so that we can be ministers for Him to preach the gospel. Amen. Lord, we thank You tonight for Your Word. Lord, we thank You for the book of Galatians. We thank You for every book, Lord, in the Bible. But Lord, we just thank You that we have the evidence, Lord, to show, Lord, what true salvation is. Lord, that it is not by the works of the law. It is not by works which we have done. Lord, even works of righteousness. Lord, we thank You that salvation is totally in Your hands. Lord, all that we have to do is believe and receive it. Lord, that we have the promise of eternal life, the promises of Abraham, the blessings of Abraham upon us, and peace upon us because of Jesus Christ, who is our peace. Lord, we just pray that You'd help us to live each day to be a witness for You, to be an example of that faith. Lord, that we might truly lead others to the cross of Jesus Christ. Lord, forgive us where we fail You. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Our altar is open for those who want to pray as we sing.
Page 259. We'll sing all four verses of Jesus Saved. 259.
all those that have believed in Jesus Christ. Those two, Father, that have that circumcision of the heart and not of the flesh. We thank you, dear Father, that we can walk in truth and in righteousness of Christ. For as your word teaches, dear Father, that he was made our sin that we might be made his righteousness.
Yeah.
Oh God, help us to walk in the light as he is in the light. Bless the many that are sick and afflicted, those who are in the hospital. God, we pray that you would just look down upon them favorably, Lord, and that you would heal their bodies according to your will. We pray for everybody on our prayer list, dear Father. You know their needs. You know those that need salvation, those, dear Father, that are fighting spiritual battle. You know, dear Father, everything about us. That's the reason we love you. That's the reason, dear God, we can go to you in prayer and know, dear Father, that your will be accomplished in our life as we submit ourselves to you. We pray, Father, that you would bless your God in the visitation program. Lord, all those that we get to witness to. And even though, Father, we have not seen one come to the knowledge of Christ in a long time, help us not to get discouraged. Help us, dear Father, to stand on the truth and stay on track. Dear Father, deliver the gospel in this community. But not only here, dear Father, thank you that we're able to support missionaries throughout the world. Thank you, dear God, that you've laid it upon our hearts, and God, that we give of our increase. But dear Father, we just pray that that increase would even be more. Lord, we know that you can do it because you are our God. We pray now, Father, again for forgiveness of sin. And we'll be careful to give you the honor and the glory and the praise in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. think I let down a few words of that.
It's
been a long time since I sang it. All right, page 3. Jesus paid it all.
Amen.
We sang this alone. I don't know if I ever even led.